Remember this little guy? Ah, yes, it's Rover from Dog N Suds. Ever wonder what happened to Dog N Suds? You ever wish you could once again sink your teeth into a coney dog or down a frosted mug of that world-famous root beer? Well, you're going to want to stick around because I have a surprise for you. Hi, this is T-Roy, and you are watching Restaurant Rewind. What happened to Dog N Suds? In the last few episodes, you'll remember we looked at three burger chains that were competing for the top spot in the burger wars. Today, in this episode, we're taking a closer look at not a burger chain, but a dog chain. Wait, what? A dog chain? Dog N Suds was a chain of drive-in restaurants that reached over 600 units. And as the name suggests, the focus was dogs. Hot dogs, that is, and suds, or root beer. For some, it has been 40 years or more since they've tasted a coney dog or sipped a frosty mug of root beer. So if Dog N Suds had over 600 locations, where'd they all go? What did happen to Dog N Suds? We'll try to answer those questions today as we revisit the early days of Dog N Suds, its rapid expansion, and subsequent decline, leaving about a dozen left, mostly in the Midwest. Wait, what? There are some left? Absolutely. And in just a bit, I will show you where you can find one. Way back in 1953, Don Hammaker and Jim Griggs were teaching music. During the school year, Mr. Griggs led the high school orchestra, and Mr. Hammaker conducted the concert choir and vocal groups. Looking for something to keep them busy during the summer months, a summertime project, if you will, the pair decided to open a hot dog and root beer stand. Jim was acquainted with a graduate student in the nearby University School of Architecture and talked him into designing a building with a butterfly-winged roof. That original design helped to shape the concept as the company expanded. The name Dog N Suds first appeared on the student's sketches, as he referred to root beer as suds, and the name stuck. This budding architect went on to become part of the infamous Frank Lloyd Wright architectural firm. And so Dog N Suds was born. And that first location was opened in Champaign, Illinois, on the corner of Prospect and Bradley. The fledgling partners had hoped to bring in $100 a day, but actually the receipts from day one consistently reached over $300. Their first Dog N Suds was opened just 1 week when a woman stopped in and posed lots of questions about the business. She asked if this was a franchise, claiming that she was interested in opening one herself. The new partners, flying by the seat of their business instincts, responded, "Why, yes." When she asked how old the franchise was and realizing she may be serious, the pair responded, "Well, it was only conceived when you asked the question." Fortunately, this woman had a sense of humor, and the partners helped her set up a business in nearby Rantoul, Illinois. And so the franchise was born. Almost from day one. The pair quickly recognized the potential that Dog N Suds held, yet at the same time knew that trying to grow the business from a single drive-in establishment to a countrywide franchise would not be a simple two-man project. Enter attorney John Franklin. Franklin helped Griggs and Hammaker find that first location, provided business acumen, and helped to set up financing, and of course provided legal advice. Before long, Hammaker and Griggs' Dog N Suds became known all throughout central Illinois. This led to them leaving the teaching profession they both loved and getting into the fast food franchising business full-time. Almost overnight, Dog N Suds drive-in restaurants began springing up all over Illinois, rapidly spreading into the adjoining states of Indiana, Ohio, and Michigan. Just 5 years after opening that first little location, the national headquarters for Dog N Suds was established in Champaign, along with an extensive training center, which of course was aptly named Rover College. Dog N Suds' growth was so phenomenal in the 1950s that one of the larger national restaurant magazines called Dog N Suds one of the soundest investments in the restaurant field and one of the best well-run franchise companies in the country. Their growth continued at a fevered pitch over the next several years, necessitating the opening of regional offices and management staff throughout the United States, as well as the expansion of the field service staff in order to keep up in the drive-in restaurant field. By 1960, Dog N Suds developed its own root beer formula and equipment. A monthly magazine called Rover, named after their beloved mascot, was published to keep all the franchise operators current on company matters. The marketing people also developed Dog N Suds uniforms, imprinted paper goods, and advertising premiums to build strength to the ever-expanding brand. Chains like McDonald's, Burger Chef, Sandy's, Henry's, Burger King, Kentucky Fried Chicken, the list goes on. Regardless of what they may have experienced in the decade following, the late 1960s were generally very solid for those chains that had a plan for growth, and Dog N Suds was no exception. In 1969, Barron's magazine picked Dog N Suds as the number one in the industry, proving that Dog N Suds had established itself as a leader in the rapidly changing restaurant industry. If you get some time, you may want to view other videos in this series, and you'll quickly discover that 1969 seemed to be a great time to be in the restaurant franchising business. As well as things were going, some big changes were about to take place, which would ultimately change Dog N Suds forever. In Don Hammaker's own words, that momentous year proved to be a turning point for the company. After 16 successful years, Jim Griggs decided he wanted to sell his stake in the company, as did attorney John Franklin. Don Hammaker wanted to bring in a few other investors and purchase the stock of Griggs and Franklin, but he had other plans as well, big plans. He wanted to take Dog N Suds public. Unfortunately, at about that same time, the Minnie Pearl Chicken debacle happened, which threw a huge wrench in those plans. If you're interested in hearing more about the Minnie Pearl Chicken debacle, leave me a comment and perhaps I can do a video on that in the near future. Still needing to buy out Griggs and Franklin, they moved forward but on a different path, selling Dog N Suds to American Licensing Company. In 1972, the corporate offices were moved from Champaign to Arlington Heights, a Chicago suburb, to provide better accessibility to prospective franchisees and existing restaurant operators. In addition, a new central warehouse and an expanded training facility were added. By 1974, Dog N Suds had grown to almost 600 units, located in 38 states and Canada, and were opening an average of 15 new restaurants each month. Think of the logistics, planning, coordinating, getting supplies and signage, hiring employees, training. In addition, an extensive far-reaching remodeling program was instituted by Dog N Suds in order to keep abreast of new trends in electronic ordering, food preparation, and beverage dispensing. Many of the new and existing operators opted to adding inside seating facilities and year-round operations. Because of the success and expansion that Dog N Suds enjoyed up to this point, the company attracted a great deal of attention and interest from numerous national, regional, competitive fast food chains. In order to keep abreast of the financial requirements for continued growth and expansion, the management of Dog N Suds elected to merge with Frosty Enterprises, a smaller East Coast-based organization that ran drive-ins, as well as made a bottled root beer product. By 1974, Frosty Enterprises purchased all the Dog N Suds stock and began the plan of reorganization and cost-cutting that would reshape the Dog N Suds landscape forever. After assuming control of the organization, Frosty made what seems to be at least two mistakes. Number one, they eliminated most of the field service staff and headquarters management staff, and they were necessary to provide field support and guidance as well as the promotional support necessary to remain competitive in a rapidly growing fast food field. And number two, they replaced the proven Dog N Suds world's creamiest root beer recipe with a different root beer concentrate that had prevailed in the eastern area of the country. But this formula was rejected by longtime Dog N Suds operators and customers. Over the next decade, Dog N Suds drive-ins experienced a fallout in their numbers. New restaurant openings vanished. Many locations dropped the Dog N Suds brand and became independent operators, abandoning what was once a valuable corporate identity. This fallout caused Frosty Enterprises to get out of the Dog N Suds business and then later sold their bottled root beer brand and formulas. In spite of the decrease in restaurant locations throughout the country, those restaurants that held true to the original Dog N Suds brand with the original signage and logo, the original world's creamiest root beer formula, and the original drive-in theme continued to prosper over the next three decades. This was particularly true in the case of Don Van Dam's thriving Dog N Suds drive-in located on Sagamore Parkway in Lafayette, Indiana. In late 1991, Don and Carol Van Dam and Associates elected to purchase the trademark and rights to the Dog N Suds brand. Don and Carol communicated to the existing operators that they had purchased the system to protect equity in this trademark in order to reactivate the organization. Feeling the brand had lost ground over the years, the Van Dams communicated that we did not buy the system for the same reasons that our predecessors did. Though we have all learned that we cannot sit still, we must move ahead or backwards, and we cannot move backwards any further than we have. In 2001, the Van Dams started a new company, TK & C's LLC, to license the Dog N Suds brand. In June of 2006, TK & C entered into an exclusive agreement with Clover Bottling Company for the bottling of the Dog N Suds root beer, which you can find in many grocery stores today. I was a little boy when the last of the Dog N Suds closed in Decatur, Illinois, near my hometown, but there is something magical about the history and the legacy that Dog N Suds has created. As far as getting your hands on a coney dog or some of those onion rings, well, you are in luck. As of 2018, there are 14 DNS locations in operation today. If you Google Dog N Suds, you can easily find a number of websites like this one that gives you some more history on the brand and links to different locations with their specific menu and hours of operation. You can also find links to their respective Facebook pages where operators like my friend David Hostico work hard to keep the Dog N Suds brand alive and well. David has been involved in the Dog N Suds business literally since he was born, and he posts daily on social media about Dog N Suds and his hashtag drive-in life. He's become a good friend, and it's inspiring to see his passion and his drive as a successful Dog N Suds operator. I was able to interview David about his experiences with Dog N Suds and the drive-in industry. Look for a video on that very soon. If you'd like to see more videos like this, please subscribe now to Restaurant Rewind using the bell icon or the link in the bottom right corner. Then check out the links to the left for similar videos. If you have some great memories of Dog N Suds in your hometown, please leave a comment below. I'd love to hear your story. Or leave me a comment below on what you'd like to see next. Thanks again. I'm Troy. God bless. Thanks for watching Restaurant Rewind.